so forget about yourself today.
So forget about yourself. Concentrate on Him and worship Him. So forget about yourself. Concentrate on Him and worship Him. So forget about yourself. Concentrate on Him.
Hallelujah.
just want to be.
Hallelujah. Amen. Glory to God. Amen. Well, it's me again. I would like to pray before we go to the word of the Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome in this place. You are welcome in this moment. I ask you that you open our eyes so we might see, and open our ears so we can hear. Lord, we open our hearts, our minds, our spirit to what you have for us today. Thank you, Lord, in advance for what you have prepared for us. Hallelujah. Amen. I'd like to start this morning reading something. I'd like to read the Apostles' Creed. And it says the following: I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended to heaven, and he seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there, he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of the saints, the forgiveness of sin, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Amen. I know that this is used widely in Catholic churches and other denominations in their services, but what a powerful declaration of faith. It's a declaration of our beliefs. It's a declaration of my beliefs. And this morning I have a few questions to ask you and to ask myself. Can you hear me okay there? I can barely hear myself here. So, as I always say, this, the questions is not only for you, it's for me and for everybody that hear these questions. So, do you believe in God? I know that some of these questions might sound very obvious, but I feel in my heart that I have to ask them this morning. Do you believe in God? The one and only God, Jehovah, Yahweh, Elohim, Shaddai, Adonai. Do you believe in the only true God? Amen. Do you believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of God? Amen. Do you believe in the Holy Spirit? Amen. Do you believe in the Word of God, the Holy Bible? Amen. Not just the book. Not just stories. The Word of God. And I know I have a digital copy here, but if I had my Bible, I would be shaking it in the air. Yes. Amen. Amen. I do believe the Word of God, and it's not just a story or many stories. So I find myself in the last few weeks reading the book of Acts. And after several times I went over some of the stories, there was one question that started sounding in my spirit and my heart louder and louder. And I'll go over and read several chapters and go back and forth, and that question starts sounding louder and louder. The question is, what happened to us? What happened to us? What happened to us as a church? What happened to us as a Christian church? And now, I'm not talking about us here only. Us as Christians around the world, churches around the world. What happened to us? I'm going to read a few verses, and I'll try to do a summary of some of the stories on the first few chapters on the book of Acts. And as I read, I hope you keep asking yourself, what happened to us? And I like to start in Acts chapter 2, verse 1 through 4. And again, I'll try to do this fast and probably skip a few verses here and there. But how many are familiar with the book of Acts? Okay. So the Bible says, when the day of Pentecost was full come, they were all in one accord in one place. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. And there appeared tongues like of fire and sat upon them. And they were filled by the Holy Ghost and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them to speak. And if we keep reading the story, the Bible says that there were many people from many nations in Jerusalem. Verse 7 says, and they were all amazed and marveled, saying one to another, behold, are not all these which speak Galileans? So they said, how come these Galileans are speaking a tongue that they're not, they're speaking something they're not, they don't know? And they all understood, these Galileans, because they were filled by the Holy Ghost. They were filled by the Holy Spirit. Verse 11 says, we do hear them speak in our tongues the wonderful works of God. So the apostles were there praying in one accord, in one spirit. Holy Spirit comes, fill their lives, give them to speak tongues, languages that they never thought. Something so supernatural. And they were being witnesses for all these other nations in Jerusalem. So some, they were saying, this is amazing. How come these people can speak the wonders of the work of God and we understand? verse 13 says, "Other mocking them, say, 'These are full of new wine.'" Never mind these people, they're drunk. But right there, the Bible says, Peter, standing up, lift up his voice. Says, wait a minute, Peter? The same Peter that a few weeks ago or months ago denied Christ? The same Peter that just a few weeks or months ago went back fishing? That same Peter stood up and lifted his voice. Yes, the same Peter. But the same Peter, full of power, filled with the Holy Ghost, filled with the Holy Spirit, because it didn't matter what happened in the past. At this moment, at this point, it was a new Peter. And the Bible says, but Peter, standing up, lifted up his voice and started to speak the words of the prophet Joel. And he started preaching about Jesus and talking about King David. And the story keeps going, saying, in that day, 3,000 people were added to the church because of the words of Peter. Yes, the same Peter, but not the same. Now he was empowered by the Holy Ghost, and he freely spoke of the wonders of God. He spoke truth. Something that catch my attention is this Peter. All of a sudden, he's a well-known, he knows the scriptures and start talking about the prophets. And if you see the story before, we know Peter. We identify with Peter many times. It was a regular guy, a fisherman. But he spent time with Jesus. And I don't know when he started learning the scriptures. Maybe it was with Jesus. Maybe he always knew it. But he never used it until the Holy Spirit came in his life. And the Bible says he spoke the words of the prophet Joel, Acts chapter 2, 17 to 21. And it shall come to pass in the last days, says God, I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. And I will pour out my spirit, and I will show wonders in heaven and signs in the earth, and it shall come to pass that whoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. And many wonders and signs were done by the apostles after that. What happened to us? What happened to us comparing to the early church? And again, I'm not talking about us as Emmanuel Worship Center or Peniel Atlanta. Us as Christian church. Shouldn't we be filled with the Holy Spirit this way? With power, no fear. Affecting not only other Christians, but the Gentiles. I'm going to get to that. What happened to us? When did we stop believing that this is possible? When did we start believing that this just was a story? And we read it and we rejoice in the stories. Oh, that was great. Why is this not possible today? And chapter 2, verse 46 says, And they continuing daily in one accord in the temple, breaking bread from house to house, did eat their meat with gladness and praising God. And the Lord added to the church daily. Let me skip over to chapter 3, verse 6 and 7. Then Peter and John go to the temple. And I guess we all know the story too. And then Peter says, I don't have money. To this man that was laying there in the temple. Silver and gold have I none, but such as I have, I give thee. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk. That simple. Obeying to the voice of the Holy Spirit. Say, I have nothing to give you, but what I have, take. Boom, miracle. Just because he was filled by the Holy Spirit and obeying the voice of the Holy Spirit. And in this story, says that the Bible says through this story that all the people at the temple were filled with wonder and amazement. And Peter is like, why do you marvel at this? I didn't do this. Why do you marvel that we heal somebody? And then he start preaching again. And because of this, the preaching at the temple right after a miracle, they were detained, there were questions, and start asking, what you doing this? What, in the name of who you doing this? And what? Who are you? Who you think you are doing those all these things? And Peter's answers were so inspired by the Holy Spirit that they couldn't do anything to him. Chapter 4, verse 13 says, now when they saw the boldness of Peter and John, they perceived that they were unlearned and ignorant men. They marvel. And they knew that they were with Jesus. Unlearned and ignorant. Amen? Unlearned and ignorant. So it wasn't even about the knowledge and the experience. It was about the power of the Holy Spirit. So they tell Peter, hey, don't do this anymore, okay? And Peter said, well, should we obey you or should we obey God? Verse 20 says, for we cannot but speak the things which we have seen and heard. We can't stop being witness. We need to obey God. Bible says they went back and testified of all the things that happened to them. Miracles, wonders, all guided by the Holy Spirit and the power
that they receive. Verse 31 also caught my attention. It says, and when they have prayed, the place was shaken where they were assembled together, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost. And they spoke the word of God with boldness. Imagine having a prayer meeting and the place starts shaking. Hallelujah. Then we see more wonders, miracles. Like I said, I'm going to probably skip over some things, but believe me, I'm trying to make a point. What happened to us? In chapter 5, verse 12, says, and by the hands of the apostle were many signs and wonders, and they were all with one accord. And this is also one thing that caught my attention. Verse 15. Chapter 5, verse 15. So the people brought the sick out in the streets and laid them on beds, that at least the shadow of Peter passing by might fall on some of them. Wow. So much power, so much anointing, so full of the Holy Ghost that we're putting sick people in the street, just waiting, expecting that Peter's shadow will pass over them, that they might be healed. Hallelujah. When was the last time somebody put a sick person on your shadow? I'm not picking on you, because nobody have done on my shadow either. Anybody? Amen or glory to God? Hallelujah? Anybody? Thank you, brother. What happened to us? We keep going. We see the story of this couple, husband and wife, that lied to the Holy Spirit. They just dropped dead. And we keep going, and they were taken and put in jail. Some of the apostles were taken and put in jail. Chapter 5, verse 17 to 20. Then the high priest rose up, and all that were with him, says it, and were filled with indignation, and lay hands on the apostles and put them in prisons. But the angel of the Lord opened the doors, brought them forth, and said, go, stand and speak in the temple. Again. Again, wonders. They were in jail because of injustice, and an angel appears, say, hey, don't worry about this. Now, Open the door. It's free. Go back to the temple. Keep preaching. Like if it was common to see an angel opening the door, say, hey, go back. And hallelujah. So they go back to the temple, start preaching again, and they're taken again and questioned again. Peter again in verse 29 says, then Peter and the other apostles answered, says, we ought to obey God rather than men. So the Bible says that they beat them. And then they let him go. They said, don't do this anymore. Next time it's going to be worse. And said, they were out. They went back rejoicing because of the suffering. They were back rejoicing on their suffering for Christ. And they kept preaching every day. If we keep going, chapter 6, we see the story of Stephen. Full of faith and power, did great wonders and miracles among the people. Chapter 6, verse 10 says, and they were not able to resist the wisdom and the spirit which by which he spoke. Filled by the Holy Spirit. Filled with power, doing miracles and wonders. Then we know that he was killed. Then we see the first mentions of Saul, what he will become Paul. He was in charge of persecuting the apostles and killing them. Let's skip to chapter 8, verse 5 to 6. We see Philip going to Samaria. Because he preached Christ unto them. And the people with one accord gave heed unto those things which Philip spoke, hearing and seeing the miracles which he did. Then verse 39 and 40. We see the story of Philip and the Ethiopian. We see Philip preaching. This man accepted Christ as Savior. Philip baptized him. And then verse 39. And when they were up, come up to the water, the Spirit of the Lord caught away Philip, that he saw him no more. But Philip was found in another city, and passing through, he preached in all the cities. Amen. We keep going. I mean, really? Nobody says glory to God. Miracles and wonders. Philip preach, baptize. When it's coming out of the water, it just disappear. Oh, that's fine. Nope. Let's keep living a life. No big deal. What happened to us? What happened to me? What happened to us as Christians? Why we stop believing this is possible today? Why we question this? Why we analyze it? Why we put a stop to it? Then we see the story of Apostle Paul, his conversion. Again, just a regular Tuesday, huh? is on a horse. This light comes around. It goes blind. A voice tells him, why you persecute me? So, yeah. And a voice tells you have to go to a city and wait there. And I tell you what to do. Guided by the Holy Spirit. He wasn't even converted yet. He was in the process. Chapter 9, verse 10 says, and there was a certain disciple of Damascus named Ananias. And to him said the Lord, in a vision, Ananias, and he said, behold, I am here, Lord. And then the Lord speak to him, this disciple, and says, arise, go to this street, go this way, go that way, and do this and the other. You know what is funny about this? Well, it's not funny, but this disciple never questioned this vision or this dream. He was questioning, you want me to do this with Paul? With this guy that's killing us? But the vision part and the Lord speaking to him and the directions that the Spirit was telling him, he said, yeah, amen. What you want me to do, Lord? What happened to us? When was the last time you were awakened with a vision from the Lord? When was the last time that he gave you instructions to follow and obey? What happened to us? I'm not going to extend much on Paul's transformation, but it's one of the things that you probably have a series of sermons about. We skip to chapter 10. We see Peter again. He was in a city called Joppa. And the story says that a well-known woman died there. Peter prayed, and the woman came back to life. Amen. Just another regular week for Peter. Because the Bible says, and we've been over almost 10 chapters, miracles and wonders and the power of the Holy Ghost and the Spirit of the Lord, it was an everyday occurrence. Then we can read about the conversion of a man named Cornelius. Chapter 10, verse 3 and 4. And this was a well-respected man, not a Jew, but a Roman. And verse 3 says, he saw a vision. An angel of God coming into him and saying, Cornelius, he was afraid and says, what is it, Lord? It says, your prayers have been heard. And the Lord tells him to send men to this city, Joppa, to find Peter. And he says, Peter's going to tell you what to do. At the same time, chapter 10, verse 9 and 11, at the same moment these men were on a journey, says Peter went up to the housetop to pray. And he was very hungry. But while they were ready, while they were made ready, he fell into a trance. And I'm reading the King James Version. He fell into a trance. And he saw heavens open. And we know the story about the sheet with the four corners and all the animals. And the Lord tells him, kill and eat. I said, Lord, I never touch anything impure. And now verse 19 and 20. Says, while Peter thought of the vision, the Spirit said to him, behold, three men seek thee. Arise therefore and get down without doubting nothing, and go with them with doubting nothing, because I have sent them. So this story is when God shows Peter that the gospel is for everybody, not just the Jews. So he goes back to meet Cornelius, and they tell each other what happened. Peter listened to Cornelius' story when he says, you know, I had a vision, and the Lord told me to go get you to the city, and that my prayers were answered, and Peter said, well, at the same time, I was here, you know, I fell into a trance and saw this vision, and I know what God is telling me to do. So they tell each other the vision, the trance, the Lord speaking to them, the angel. And then Peter start preaching again. Verse 44. We have verse 44, chapter 10, says, while Peter yet speak these words, the Holy Ghost fell on them, all of them. And they of the circumcision which believed were astonished, as many as come to with Peter, because of the Gentiles also was poured out the gift of the Holy Ghost. They heard speaking in tongues and magnify God. Miracles and wonders and being filled by the Holy Spirit, empowered by the Holy Ghost. Then we see Peter going back again to Jerusalem. And when he gets there, this time is being questioned by, I guess, the other apostles and other people and the church in there. And you know, like I said about all these other miracles and wonders, and I think it's funny, but not funny, they were questioning Peter about, what do you mean do this? You sit down and have a meal with a Gentile? That was why they were questioning Peter when he went back to Jerusalem. What do you mean you did this? You have a meal with a Gentile? Forget about the vision, the angel, the trance, God talking to two people in two different cities. They were, you know, like I said, it's a regular Tuesday. There's no problem with that. They believe that that was real and happening in an everyday occurrence. What happened to us? Why we believe that this is just a story for that time. why we believe that this was only for the apostles. Well, Ed, this is only for those that are called to do great things. This is not for everybody. You know what? It also makes me feel uncomfortable when, you know, these things start happening. The Holy Spirit takes control and I'm not in control, and I have to live my life according to what God speaks, and I'm not too comfortable with that. I mean, yes, amen, I believe in God and Jesus, the Holy Spirit, and but makes me feel uncomfortable. What happened to us? When the Holy Spirit started moving, not only in the services, in our lives, do we rejoice or we start questioning and analyzing? And lifting our shield to see first. Let me think about this. Let me put it in perspective. Do you believe what Peter said when he stood up and spoke about the prophet? You don't believe it because Peter said it? Well, let's read what Prophet Joel said. Joel chapter 2, verse 28 to 32. This is the prophet. It says, and it shall come to pass that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and daughters shall prophesy, your old men shall dream dreams, your young men shall see visions, and also upon the servants and upon the handmaids in those days I will pour out my spirit, and I will show wonders in the heavens and in the earth. Amen. I believe this. I expect this. I want this. What happened to us that we question everything? That we filter everything, that we even start judging. We say, no, this is not okay. This is not from the Lord. Some were mocking them. Some were questioning them. And some were filled with indignation. We just read that. But the apostles were in one spirit, in one accord. I can see it throughout all the stories that we just went through. And I'm going to repeat it to you. Acts chapter 2, verse 1. When the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. Chapter 2, verse 46. And they, continuing daily with one accord in the temple. Chapter 4, verse 32. And the multitude of them that believe were in one heart and of one soul. Chapter 5, verse 12. And by the hands of the apostles were many signs and wonders among the people, and they were all in one accord. I think this is one of the keys. This is one of the secrets. That the apostles were all in one spirit, in one accord, waiting for the fulfillment of his promise. They didn't care about what happened in the past. This was a new day, a new chapter. They were burning inside. Nothing will stop them. They said, the Bible says, they will rejoice in their suffering. Hallelujah. Father, in the name of Jesus, I ask, please help us to be in one accord. Help us to be in one spirit. I want this power in my life. I want this life. I want this overflow of your Holy Spirit. Lord, I want to see your church, the youth, myself, my children, to lose control in your will, to lose control in your Holy Spirit. I want to see the youth filled with your Spirit without any questions, without any fear. Be expecting of these things and many more. Because now, more than ever, we need your Holy Spirit. We need to be guided day by day. Not what we want to do, but you want us to do. Help us, Lord, to hear your voice. Help us, Lord, to identify the Holy Spirit waking up at night, or when we drive in, or when we are at home, or when we are at the supermarket. Help us identify the voice of the Holy Spirit so we can obey promptly, without questions, without fear. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. Before we go and dismiss, I'd like to sing a song. And I hope this war at least keep sounding in your heart. And you keep asking, if we are there, great. Glory be to God. But if we're not, let's ask for the strength of keep going to achieve this in our lives, in our church, in our family. Amen. Welcome, Holy Spirit. Be here with your presence. Fill me with your power. Live inside of me.
Welcome, Holy Spirit. Be here with your presence. Fill me with your power. Live inside of me. You're the living water, never drying fountain, comforter and counselor, take complete control. Welcome, Holy Spirit. Be here with your presence. Fill me with your power. Live inside of me. Welcome home.